In video number 75, I showed how to split Loconet into one or several subnets and use a middleman function to manipulate the message flow between, say, a throttle and the command station. This technique allows for adding additional functionality and security layers to a layout, but to make it work properly, we have to deal with some problems that are the result of how Loconet is specified. So let's have a closer look. Welcome to the IoTT channel, I am Hans Tanner. The last video drew quite some interest, so I want to thank all of you who left a like or commented on the content. One comment I would like to point out here. McKinley Railway wrote, "We are doing similar things using two local buffers to manipulate the responsiveness of throttle function keys." They use middleman functionality to make sure that all locomotive functions like sounds or uncouplers are on the same function buttons for all locomotives. And they also make latching function buttons non-latching where it makes sense. Furthermore, they have the middleman function watching loco speeds, and if a locomotive that is no longer assigned to a throttle is still moving, it gets stopped after a defined period of time to prevent damage. Nice to see that there are other folks using Loconet to implement rather unconventional functionality. Now, the way they are doing it is placing the middleman on a computer between two loco buffers, in other words, a very fast connection between the command station network and the subnet with almost zero latency, which is the key to make it work, as we will see in just a minute. In my case, however, I am feeding the Loconet messages over Wi-Fi to an MQTT broker and from there over Wi-Fi back into the other network. This may add a few milliseconds of latency when using a local broker and a few dozens of milliseconds in case I am using a public broker over the internet. To understand why this latency might cause problems, we need to have a look at how Loconet works and how it compares to other networks. A good way to understand and classify networks is to compare them to the 7-layer ISO Open System Interconnection model. Layers 1 through 3 in that model are sometimes also called the media layers and describe the elements of a local network. The higher level layers describe the elements needed for communication between networks. To understand Loconet, we therefore can compare the Loconet specification to layers 1 through 3 of the OC model. Well, as it turns out, the physical layer of Loconet is well defined, including electrical characteristics, bit timing, network access and message format. But that's it. There is simply no such thing as a defined data link or network layer. Loconet nodes have no addresses, no MAC address, nor an IP address. Now, don't get me wrong, I am not saying this is bad. It is just a fact that we have to keep in mind when trying to do, so to speak, advanced stuff like forming a Loconet subnet. But overall, I think that not having a data link layer is more to our advantage, as it avoids a lot of network management traffic. The good news is that in most cases the lack of a data link layer is not a problem, since all messages are broadcasted and all connected Loconet nodes are receiving the entire data stream that comes over the network, and they simply ignore messages they have no use for. Let's say, for example, I want to set a turnout from my handheld throttle. I click the button and the throttle sends out a switch request message. This message is seen by all attached Loconet devices. Some of them might be switch decoders, so they can process the message and set the turnout if the address falls in their range. Other devices, like another handheld throttle, may ignore the message. The command station, on the other hand, will convert the message into a DCC command and send it out to the track. The point is, none of these receivers really needs to know where the message is coming from. Therefore, for this example, a data link layer providing individual node addresses is not needed. And with regards to the latency aspect I discussed earlier, it also does not matter if the message arrives a few milliseconds earlier or later, so no problem with this type of messages. But then there are these other messages. Messages that have a reply message, that is. Here, the missing data link layer is a problem, because it is not possible to identify from what node the reply is coming from. And furthermore, latency and network interconnection through a broker are problematic as well, because if there is a delay, one reply message could be surpassed by another one, and now it is impossible to determine which reply belongs to which request. Now just assume one reply is a failure message, while the other one is a confirmation, and the mess is complete. To avoid a situation like this, Loconet makes use of a pretty dirty trick. First of all, if we look over the list of messages that have a reply message, we see that the receiver of all of them is the command station. It is all messages that have to do with slot management, so the assignment of locomotive addresses and assembling or disassembling consists. The only exceptions are switch commands with acknowledge and immediate transmission of a DCC command to the track. Both of them also only make sense for a command station, so the sender of a reply message always is the command station. According to the Loconet standard, the command station has a higher priority to access Loconet than every other node in the network, and that is the key to the solution for the sequencing problem. If the command station receives a command that expects a reply, it uses its higher priority to make sure that the very next message that goes over the network is the reply to the previous request. And just in case the calculation of the reply takes a while, it sends out busy messages to make sure no other node can arbitrate the network while the reply message is being prepared. Problem solved. At least, as long as we are just talking about the command station network. Now, when we use these messages from a subnet and send them through a man-in-the-middle node to the command station, problems may occur. Let's follow an example to identify them. A throttle in a subnet is sending a switch status request message. After sending the message, the subnet remains blocked for all other nodes to transmit for 20 bit times, or 1.2 milliseconds, according to the Loconet specification. So if the latency caused by the detour through the man in the middle is more than that, the subnet is reactivated before the reply, or at least the busy message from the command station arrives, and another node may start transmitting, which breaks the rule that the reply immediately follows the request. This is for sure the case if the man in the middle detour includes a public broker in the internet. Most likely it is also the case when the broker runs in the same network. If we use local buffers instead, as McKinley does, the latency caused by the man in the middle should not be a problem, but we are still not off the hook because the Loconet side of the local buffer is designed to work as Loconet node. Therefore, it observes also a 1.2 millisecond network access delay. So, in the worst case, it might try to send the reply message into the subnet at the exact same time another node starts transmitting a new message. Quite an interesting problem, so you might be interested to see how I fixed it in the IoTTstick software. First, as already mentioned in video number 75, I added a new setup option, Loconet Subnet, for the Loconet interface. When activated, it gives the IoTTstick command station priority for Loconet access. So instead of waiting 1.2 milliseconds after the last message, it can start sending immediately. And second, when in subnet mode, I made it behave like a command station, so it starts sending busy commands to the Loconet side while waiting for the reply message from the command station network. Let me show you how this looks in the Loconet viewer. On the left side we see the traffic in the subnet. The command station network traffic is on the right side. The process starts when the throttle sends a switch state request message. The IoT stick detects a message that requires a reply from the command station and therefore starts to inject busy messages into the subnet. At the same time, the request gets sent via MQTT broker to the command station network, where it is received by the command station. The command station might insert a busy message as well and then send the switch status included in a long acknowledge message. The reply makes it via gateway and MQTT broker to the subnet, and as soon as it is received, the IoTT stick stops sending busy messages to the LocoNet and inserts the reply immediately following the last busy message using command station priority rights. From there, it is then received by the throttle, and the throttle displays the switch position, thrown or closed, accordingly. The number of busy messages inserted into the subnet, of course, depends on the experienced latency. It can be a few dozen depending on the load of the Wi-Fi and the broker. But just to be sure, I also added a timeout, so if no reply is received, the subnet goes back to idle after about 100 milliseconds. That looks pretty good on the message level, but to be sure, I used the oscilloscope to have a detailed look at the network signal. Here is how it looks like. The first 4 bytes are the local address interrogation command BF sent by the throttle. Then there is a break of a little less than 1 millisecond, which is less than the 20 bit times other nodes need to access the network. So this is safe. Next follows a sequence of 3 busy commands sent by the IoTT stick into the subnet to avoid that any other node is able to transmit. And then the E7 reply message back to back with the last busy message. This looks good, but it still needs a little more work because right now I cannot guarantee the below 1 millisecond delay between the last bit of the query and the start bit of the busy message. It can be as long as 2 milliseconds in the worst case, but in order to change that, I need to make some conceptual changes to the LocoNet library. Maybe you wondered why there are only 3 busy commands, while in the example before, there were many more. The reason is that for this screenshot to fit the time window of the oscilloscope screen, I did not send the command via MQTT, but put the IoTT stick in command station mode. So the reply came from the IoTT stick acting as a LocoNet command station. The timing of the busy code I was interested in is the same in both cases. It is just fewer busy messages. And yes, you heard right, the IoTT stick pretty soon will also feature a command station mode. It is called Red Hat +++. But what that stands for is material for a future video, and if you don't want to miss it, you probably want to subscribe to the IoTT channel and hit the bell icon so you are in a premium seat when that video is published. Now, just to have a benchmark for the LocoNet signal the IoTT stick is sending out here, I also looked at the signal created by a Digitrax DCS100 command station. Here it is. And to my big surprise, it has breaks of about 1.5 milliseconds between the query and the first busy message, as well as between the last busy bit and the E7 reply message. Now, this particular DCS100 is one of the first that came out, so it is about 25 years old, and newer command stations probably will do better. But based on this screenshot, I would say that the signal is not failsafe, as in the worst case, another node could access the network between 2 commands. It is unlikely, for sure, but I think it is technically possible and a communication error could occur. And that's enough technical mumbo-jumbo for this week. I certainly congratulate you if you are still watching. And if you even learned something new about the ugly details of LocoNet communications, please click the like button below or share your thoughts in the comment section. As always, doing so helps to promote this video and the IoTT channel in general, and I like to hear from you anyway. Thanks for watching and see you in the next video.